Hey, Dr. Dan here. Today we're going to create a basic JavaScript mathematical art app, web app, and in the process we're going to keep with good design patterns. We're going to code integrating Bootstrap, and we're just going to learn some basic JavaScript skills and follow good workflow and best practices using GitHub. All right, so let's get started. First, let's make a new repository. So this is my GitHub account. Let's call this repository MathArt and create. All right, so we have a repository. Now we're going to open a Node.js command prompt. I have Git installed. And let's cd to my documents Git folder. And let's git clone this URL. And it's warning us we've created an empty repository. That's okay. Let's cd to it. All right, so now I think I will code this using Dreamweaver because I want to see live updates on my code. It's a very visual app we're going to be making, so this will help quite a bit. Let's give that a chance to spin up. Okay, there it goes. So let's close down these and we are going to create a new HTML. We can give it a title. Why don't we be fancy? Okay. And we won't attach a CSS at this point. Let's create. All right, now we want to save this in the location of our Git repo as an index.html. So we'll go to Documents, Git, MathArt, save right there. All right. So now let's go ahead and link up that repository. So let's see, tool. Switch over to our Git view. And we have nothing so far, so we need to link this repository. So let's manage sites. Let's make a new site. And associate this folder with that site. And we want to associate a Git repository, but it knows that it already is. So if we save it, now our Git repository should be associated. Okay, good. It's showing that that's a change. All right. So we have a blank site. Let's make sure that we have Bootstrap to begin with. So I'm just going to go to Bootstrap's home, get started, and I'm going to grab their starter template. And then I'm going to paste that into here. We can start with that. Let's save it. And over here in our live view, we should see good, hello world. All right, so I'm gonna make some space between those jQuery scripts. I have some space to work with. And then we are going to need a few more links. So we're gonna need a JavaScript file. So let's go to new JavaScript, create, and we'll save this as just art.js. Okay, we're gonna need a link to that. So let's do a let's do a link to that at the bottom here with our other scripts. Source equals art.js type equals text. I need to let it know that the browser know that we're dealing with a JavaScript script. To that, we're also going to need a style sheet. So let's make a new CSS and let's save this as style.css. Okay, let's provide a link to that now at the top here under Bootstrap so it has priority. So now we have Bootstrap and a link to two style sheets. So the first thing I'm going to do is get rid of this hello world, and let's just put some Bootstrap centered text. Going to do that to define what we're going to put in to center what Jumbotron, which we're going to put in. So this is a Bootstrap component, and it's just going to draw attention to a particular element, and inside of that we can put just the normal h1. And we can use a Bootstrap class display for for the type of text, whoops, style. And then we can just say create mathematical art. And then in here we can put a p element, and we can give that a LED type display. And we can just tell them create a work of art below using the buttons. Probably don't need exclamation point there. And then let's put an HR here. This is just for styling, and what we're going to do is just have a P that tells them delete a shape by double clicking on it. We'll add this functionality, bring it to the forefront by single clicking. Save. Let's see the results. There we go. All right, beautiful. So now we have some instructions. What we're going to need are some buttons at this point. So I'm going to center this again. Let's bring this up so we know that it is associated with that. And let's do another div class equals, oops, class equals text center, so it's centered. And inside of that, let's do a actually, let's have, so the canvas that we'll be painting to, let's make right here under that Jumbotron, so div class equals, so we're just going to use a container, and we're going to make it fluid, so it expands the size of the parent, and later we can adjust the pixels of that container through our overriding CSS class that loads after the Bootstrap class. For now, let's just give this an ID and call it art. Okay. And that should be good. Alright, below that we'll have our button group inside of this text center. So let's use another Bootstrap component called button group. There it is. We'll give it a role group and a type of label. Well, we don't even need that, really. Okay. So there's our button group. Now, inside of that, we're going to have our buttons. So we want just a normal button, and this is just to let the browser know what it is, and then for Bootstrap, we'll put a button secondary. And we need an ID here. And let's set that equal to add s for add square. Actually, let's just go ahead and give it the full name. Let's just keep with add s. I like that. And we need to surround this with okay, quotations. And then we'll give the button a name, add square. All right. Let's copy that and paste it twice. And let's give the ability to add a circle. And then let's have a clear button, which clear shapes. It can clear all their shapes if they want to. All right, so each of these have a separate ID, and we are going to reference that ID from the JavaScript class. Okay. And that is all we're going to do for HTML. Okay, so let's switch over to our JavaScript. So the first thing we're going to do is set a window.onload function so that we can get a reference to those buttons. And inside of there, we can declare our variables for the buttons, and we'll use the document.get element by ID and just feed in the ID here. So this is just the JavaScript document object model functionality. We can grab an ID, and we're going to set the onClick listener to a function which we'll call addSquare. And let's copy that. Paste it twice. And do the same for add circle. And we'll have a variable called clear, which we'll attach to the clear button. And we'll call this function clear all. All right, so now we have a reference to all those functions. Save that. And what's wrong here? Oh, that's okay. So now let's have a clear all function first. And after that, let's have a function called add square. And after that, let's have a function called add circle. Those won't take any parameters. All right. Still one error, which is, oh, that's okay too. And all right, so let's handle add square first. So let's, before we add that functionality, switch over to our style.css class and set some basic style here. So we can set the background of the entire document to white. We can change that later. Let's define a class called square that we can then modify it later. And in that class, we'll set a default width of 50 pixels, the default height of 50 pixels because it's a square, and we'll set its position to absolute. And we'll do the same for a circle class, except on the circle class, we'll set the border radius to 50%. So we'll pull in the corners basically until it is a circle. And then finally, we have an area called art that we have an ID for. So let's set the width of that to something like 800 pixels and the height to 400 pixels. So we'll get a nice rectangle. We'll set its position to relative and we'll set its background color to black. And that is all I think we're gonna need here. Let's save that. Alright, so now back over in art.js, what we want to do is first set up a variable called square, and what we'll do for square is actually create an element, and the type of element we'll create, we'll just make a div. So we're just going to use JavaScript to create an element on the fly whenever someone clicks that button. And now we can define properties of that element, like its class name. We can set the square so that it inherits those default square attributes we just defined. And then we can set its location from the left corner to a basic JavaScript function. So we want to return an int. We're going to use the math.random, and we'll multiply by so that'll give us a number between 1 and 0. We can just multiply that times 800, which is our width, and then we'll add a string to that so that it becomes a string because we're setting the style. So we're returning a number from here, we're turning that double into an int, and then we're turning that int into a string, and then we're setting the style of the CSS of the square that we just made with JavaScript to a pixel location, which we define with that string. All right, so I'm gonna copy that. We're gonna do the same thing for its position. So this is just gonna give us a random position for this element. And we want top here. And so from the top, we want something 400, something between 400. All right, now we want to define its color now, background color, and let's get a random color. And then let's define that function down here. Alright, so we need to return a string for this. So let's just have an array, or a string basically, of letters that can function as a hexadecimal value, so A, B, C, D, E, F, hex goes up to F, and we'll have to add the end of that a hashtag, or sorry, to the beginning of that, a hashtag, and so then let's just go through that string. 6 times because we need a 6 value number, and we'll just append each time that that random, well, we need to make it random, so we need to pull from letters at a certain index. So let's give it a random index. Parse int, and we'll use the math.random function again. Ugh, auto returns drive me crazy. And we'll just get a function from letters.length. Okay. So 6 times we'll go through and we'll pick some random integer here inside of this letter is by using its length as the random value. We multiply a double between 0 and 1 times that, and then we parse it into an int, and then we take whatever character, so like 5 or wherever we're at in the from the return value of this. We take that character and we add it to result. So in result, we'll see something like 1A. So it'll be first a hashtag, right? And then it'll append 1, 9, 4, A, D, F. And then it'll return from this loop. Okay, so then we'll return result. And up here, we're setting the background color to the return of this. So to a string, basically. All right, so we have a position. Now we need to we can change its height and width if we wanted. So let's create a variable called random width and set that to we'll use our parseInt trick again with math.random, and we'll multiply that. So we'll set that somewhere between 40 and 20. Oops, I don't need that there. So that'll return a value, sorry, between 40 and 60. So we'll get a number between 0 and 40 from this, and then we'll add 20 to it, and we'll get a number between 40 and 60. And then let's copy this. Do it again here for height. And we could define a function that did this as well if we wanted, but let's just stick with this for now. We'll modify it later as we go. So now we have a random height separate from the random width. And all right, so now we're ready to set the circle, or sorry, the square dot style dot width, which was by default 50, to rand w. And square.style.height to h. Okay. Finally, we need a function that interprets when a user has clicked it. So we can actually set an onClick for this div to make it reactive and set that function to something called front click. So we'll have to have a function here called front click. We won't do anything for that for now. finally, let's grab the element, the art area, and let's set that equal to document dot get element by ID. What was the ID? Oh, just art. Okay, so that is the tag, that the ID that we have in our document. And then from art area, we can append a child, which will make this circle. All right. Random color is not defined. Did we misspell something here? Get random color. Ah. Have to let that know that it's a function. Oops. All right. And then circle is not. Oh, I switched to circle all of a sudden. We're going to do the same thing for circle, so I'm sort of half in circle mode. All right, we want to append the square, and we don't mind about the strict statement areas. So now let's switch back to our index, and let's save, and let that refresh. And so we should get a div that's a little bigger here in just a second. All right, so we have a bit of a bug here. So let's see. Properties, perhaps? Aha. All right, so we've got the width. The height is not set. So let's go ahead and set that to 400px. There we go. Let's go to Chrome. And we are in Documents, Git. Math Art. Let's open this with just Chrome. And there we go. So yeah, we're having a problem with Dreamweaver rendering. As you can see, we've got a few bugs. So on the height, we need to subtract the maximum height of a square to get these to not overflow on that side. Oh, and the same thing with width. All right, so we don't have clear shapes or add circle working yet, but everything else works pretty nicely. So at this point, I am going to close down Dreamweaver because it's not working for us. I'm going to pull that over to the side, and I'm going to go to my repo, and I'm going to do git status. So you can see that I have a few files that I want to add, so I'll just add all of them with git add star. Hit git status again, you can see that they are added. Let's commit them with a message, square, random square working. And then git status. Okay, it's saying our upstream's gone, so let's git pull. Ooh, okay. Pull origin master, git push origin master. How about that? Ah, that's why I'm not signed in. Okay, so now we're pushing to master. Let's go check it. There's our code. Great, okay. So now to open up the code in a better editor, I'm just gonna use atom. I'm gonna hit atom dot to open up this whole project at once. So there is our code. And let's go ahead and move this over here so we can see changes. We'll have to refresh every time we make a change, but should be fine. Let's just test it out. So if we save here and refresh here, we've got it. Okay. So moving from Dreamweaver to Atom, good thing to know how to do when Dreamweaver is not working for you. All right. So let me make this a bit smaller and make this a bit smaller. And we don't really need such a big project folder. We can even pull this over a bit so we can see all our code. All right, back in art.js. Okay, so let's add some, so far we have the ability to add a square whenever we want, and we have a little bug where our squares are hanging over the edges right here. So let's fix that bug first. So in our add square, when we set the pixel location, our squares can go up, go from 40 to 60 pixels. So let's subtract 60 from here to accompany the fact that the pixel location is the start of the width. So and then we'll similarly subtract 60 from here. So that'll be okay. So that should solve that bug. Let's test it out. Let me shrink this down a little bit. Okay. Good. So we have them all inside of our area here. Very cool. Alright, so next thing to do is let's duplicate this functionality for circle, and it's going to be pretty much exactly the same here. We'll have a circle, variable, and just to keep things straight, we could have called it square as well. Make it class type circle. Everything else stays the same. The only difference in our CSS is circles have rounded borders, so we can save that and then make sure that functionality works. It sure does. Very cool. Oh, they are all the same size though. Interesting. Is that just a product of... Same size, interesting. So we have a new bug here. So in our style.css for our circle class, let's comment out these, comment out these default height and widths. And see what happens now. So now we get nothing. Let me save again. Interesting. So What if we give these different class names? I'm wondering if there's a Bootstrap class. We save those, and then in our index, we can leave those like that. In our style dot our art.js, let's give the class name Circle Custom and Square Custom. Save. Still all the same size. How interesting. All right. So the size variable is happening here. Getting a random value. Between 40 and adding 20 to it. That all looks fine. We set the width and height to those two values. To add px to it. The very end of this, after we parse an int, let's add px and make it a phrase because that's getting overwritten. Let's put parentheses here, parentheses here. There we go. So circles are still the same. So let's just grab those, Control C, and plop them down here. In fact, we really only need one method for that, don't we? That's okay for now. We will simplify the code later. So we save that, reload this, and our circles are now anything from ellipses to circles. Cool. We're still every shape of the spectrum. All right, let's implement the clear. Let's add a function. Oh, did we already have a function for that? We did. All right. So we'll have a var art area equals. Let's be consistent here. Stick with camel case. Let's have a var art area equals what do we want to do here? Document dot get element by ID. Get element by ID. Art is our ID. And then let's have a var for shapes equals get element tag name. So anything with the tag name div, we'll grab. equal common our shapes. Dot length minus one. I greater than or equal to zero. Minus. So we'll set the value high, and as we remove them, we will grab the element in that array, and we'll go to its parent node, which is the art area. And from the art area, we can remove child, and we'll remove itself. So we're using the element to index up, to navigate up to the parent node, which is our art area. And then from that art area, we're removing that very element. Okay. And that is how we will clear all the shapes. Let's test that functionality out. Not working. All right, let's see what the problem is. So if I hit Control Shift I, I can take a look at my console. And we have document by tag name. Get element by tag name is not a function. Ah, it's not a function of document. It is, however, a function of art area. Cool. All right, let's try that again. Art area dot. Oh, I didn't like that either. I'll get element. How about that? Huh. Oh, right, we've got some art area. Interesting. Oh, elements. Okay. Sounds little bugs, man. Oh my goodness. Say, not my day for little bugs. All right. So now elements is not defined. Where are we talking about elements? Oh, shapes. That. All right, we are good to go. Cool. Okay, so let's say we wanted to add something like a triangle now at this point. Triangles are kind of hard in CSS. You have to do a little trick with the borders, similarly to how you do in with a circle. First, let's implement front click. So for this method, we're going to need a constant, which we'll call a global, which we'll call max z. So this will be our z index, max z. We'll set it to 1,000. Save. And then down here, we can have a var. Let's see, what do we need? We'll need to grab its old z index. So the z index is just its position relative to other elements to the to the viewpoint of the user. So var old z, we can set equal to parseInt this dot style dot z index. So we'll grab the z index of whatever it is we're clicking on, and then we'll say if old z equals max z, then we will this dot parent, we'll remove it by navigating up to the parent node and then removing the child of that parent, which is this. If it's not, we'll move it to the forefront. So otherwise, we're going to increase the max z so that always is navigatable, won't be replaced by anything. And we can do style z index of this and set that equal to max z. Okay, so that's how we'll handle a front click. Let's make sure that that works. So let's add a bunch of stuff. We need some overlap to check that it's working. So we have this one behind, let's click on it once, comes to the front, click on it again, and it disappears. All right, cool. So that works. The last thing I want to do is, let's say we wanted to add a triangle. It's going to be very similar to this functionality. So first we could define a function called addTriangle. We would have a variable called triangle. We're going to create a div just like the other one, and then let's make this triangle custom. So let's go to make that class now in style.css, and for our triangle class, we want actually to have a width of 0 and a height of 0, and the border on the left side, we'll make this an upwards facing triangle for now. Later on we can rotate it, and we'll set its default to solid transparent so you can't see it. And same for border right. We'll set to 40px solid transparent. And then for our border bottom, we can set that for now to 40px solid white, and then we can override that later. And let's set the position to absolute, otherwise we'll get a stack of triangles that will extend beyond our area. Alright, so that'll be our triangle custom class over here in our art.js. We'll reference that class there. And then for the style left and top, we'll use the same trick to fix a random location. Now we'll set a variable rand c to a random background color, and we'll just call this rand b because all our borders are going to be the same value. And then instead of setting the width and height, which are always going to be 0, we'll do circle.style.border right. And the reason that these are camel case instead of a dash like they are over in CSS, if you take a look, is that JavaScript interprets these dashes as, and the next letter, as just camel casing. So border right, border left, and circle.style.border bottom, and these we're gonna set equal to something a little different. Let's see, what we want is a string that begins with the rand b, so some pixels plus, and we'll put a space, and we want solid and then the color. So for these, it'll be solid transparent, and that'll be exactly the same. Oops. Here, and then here we want solid, but instead of transparent, we will add our rand c, which we defined up here by getting a random color. We'll leave the on click, and then we want to make sure we're appending the triangle there, and we need to change these over as well to triangle. And save that, but we're not quite done. In on load now, we need another function. And this function's going to be called addT for triangle, and we'll look for an ID in HTML called addT, and then the function name is addTriangle, and we're going to add that to the variable addT, which is actually going to be that going to translate into that div. So over an index, right below this button group, okay, we'll have a button called ID'd by addT, and we'll call it addTriangle. Save. Now, if we go back, we have an add triangle function, which is working. Hooray! Alright. So we can add triangles, we can add circles, look at that marvelous art, and we can add squares. And any particular one of these, we can click on them once to bring them to the forefront, click on them twice to delete. So I'm going to save this. I'm happy with it as a beginning of Bootstrap JavaScript, how to use arrays with the clear shapes, how to call the document object model. Oop, little bug there. We'll have to pull in that width a little bit more for the triangle. We can fix that right now. So in art.js, let's pull that in another 20. Oops, that's okay. But in triangle, because the border is a little different, let's pull that down to 720 and 320. Okay. It's sort of hard to test at this point, so I just have to trust I got the mathematics right. There we go. How to use arrays, how to debug with two different text editors, one that was Dreamweaver that we gave up on, and then when we switched over to Atom, because Dreamweaver wasn't rendering Bootstrap buttons or divs very well. So we switched over to Atom, and then the console, and the console and elements of the Chrome browser for debugging, and how to and so now at this point, let's follow good design pattern principles and do a git status, git add all, git commit dash m, working buttons for randomizing triangles, squares, circles, and clearing all push origin master. And there we go. So this code I'll keep up on GitHub under math art, and I will update with future tutorials. But for now, that's a very quick basic lesson in JavaScript and how to incorporate that into Bootstrap. Thank you. See you next time.